Hey, hey, hey! Welcome back to First Frequency of One is Shock Metaphysics. It's Thursday, family. Let's get it on and popping. It's me, the Ball Wonder, Reverend Philippe Shock Matthews, aka the Metaphysical Morpheus. Special message. Here we go. Let's do it.
One with the first frequency. I am one with the first thought idea. I am one with the first born people. I am one with the only one. Ashe, so it is. Greetings, family. My name is Amra, and I've been asked to pour a libation for this event to open the way in our tradition. Before I go any further, I would like to ask an elder in the house if I have permission to speak.
Yes.
I would also ask from the invisible realm. I'll be speaking a little bit in Yoruba and in English. Please join me with Ashe. Ibashe laorun. I pay homage to the East. Asheo.
Asheo.
Ibashe iwo orun. I pay homage to the West. Asheo. Ibashe ariwa. I pay homage to the North. Asheo.
Asheo.
Ibashe gusu. I pay homage to the South. Asheo. Ibashe ile ife. I pay homage to the earth. Asheo.
Asheo.
Now, I would like you to join me and raise your voices and call upon, invoke the ancestors that are near to you. I call upon Thelma and Newton Anderson. Asheo. I call upon Marcus Messiah Garvey. Asheo. I call upon Queen Nanny. Asheo. I call upon Harriet Tubman. Asheo. I call upon Malcolm Omawale X. Asheo. I call upon all the ancestors. Ibashe, Ibashe, Ibashe. I call upon all the ancestors that come to us. He called you to open the way. Open the way. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. Okay, now we're going to chant. We're going to bring in Ilegba with drum and voice. Join me. I will call and you will respond. Very easy. We're saying, Ilegba, go. Come and open the way.
And that's how we do it. That's how we do it. Welcome back, family. It's Thursday. That means it's time for the man with the plan to put the knowledge, the black knowledge, in your hand. It could only be the man who stands 6'3", fights white supremacy all day, day, from Chicago, the Chi-Town, the Windy City. He puts the plan in the hand. There he is. It's the one. It's the only. Dr. Clyde Winters. What's going on, my beloved Bobo? You got to turn your mic back on. See, you had your mic off in reference to our libation. Turn your mic back on.
Yeah, it's everything is copacetic, man. It's you know, what up, though?
What up, though?
Yeah, you know, it's very exciting, you know, and I love to see Amra and see her present, you know.
Oh, she's got some stuff coming, man. I'm going to be working with her Monday on AI with her, and I'm so excited. I assume you got the paper as well, but I'm really, really excited. Rhonda Lewis sent her paper.
Yeah.
And it was magnificent. Oh, my God. I'm so proud of this group that is coming forth. It took them a little bit of time, but your research course, man, is presenting. Because I didn't know any of that. I'm going to use some of that work. Once she gets it published, we put it up on Academia.edu. I'm going to quote her paper in some upcoming books that I'm currently writing. So it was absolutely incredible. So proud of you, Rhonda Lewis. Giving you a shout out, beloved. A shout out. You did it. You did it. You did your paper. You did what most people who spent all that money didn't do, and that was you did it. You finally did it, and it was amazing. Go ahead, Doc.
Well, the good thing is that anybody that knows that's taking the class, like I'm telling you, is that it's not if you get everything done doing the class, as long as you get it done. And I'm here.
Right.
I'm here.
Right.
And you know, I mean, you guys got my telephone number. You got my email. And I'm here to help you so you can continue. Because, see, you got to remember, doing research is like any creative process. A creative process takes time. A creative process also, in a sense, you can't do everything right away. That's just not the creative spirit. And so what if it takes you a year, 2 years? You know, you got the tapes of the class. And so then therefore, in a sense, you just take your time and you wait till the spirit hits you. When the spirit hits
Absolutely.
You, you're going
Absolutely.
To be able to put, you're going to be able to put all the stuff together, you know. Rhonda, she had a very difficult time because, you know, the whole idea that she was mainly interested in numismatics. Numismatics mm-hmm. is the study of coins and coinage. And what happened was is that she was always struck by the fact is that what was the African influence? What was the what about Africans and coins? And because, you know, the rest of the world, beginning with the Persians, they had these coins.
Right.
But see, the currency.
Oh, it was such a good paper. Oh my God.
Right. The currency among Black people was shells, seashells, and you could use this currency of seashells all the way from East Africa to China.
But the other thing she did, she showed that we invented, yet again, first frequency. We created the first commerce system.
Yeah.
That lasted 5,000 years.
Right.
And you talk about this all the time. They just they try to act like it's now myth that it, you know, it couldn't be possible. Yeah. So this was when we talk about Africana phenomenology, we talk about the research gap within philosophy. This was one of the greatest contributions to let people know, because nobody's writing about this. I didn't know any of this information. And wouldn't even know where to begin to start researching. I mean, I would have my way about it, but Rhonda, she did a damn thing. I am so proud of that paper. I really am.
Yeah, and the good thing about it is that you know, it's something people need to know, because Rhonda also is a novelist, and she has one of her books has already been books has already been published.
Yeah.
And
that's right.
And what makes it so exciting is when we talked to her last Saturday, you know, when you did the class, mm-hmm. when we talked to her last Saturday, Rhonda was talking about the fact is that, because I wanted to go buy the book now. She said, no, don't buy it now. Because she wants to kind of change it add a lot of stuff to it and see. Yeah. That's the type of stuff. See, family, as I tell you out there, is that, you know, remember, if you guys, those of you who have been with us since we began, now we're going into our third year. But those of you who've been with us when we began, the whole idea was that, hey, I'm 70 some years old. I got one foot in the grave, but we need you, family. We need you to tell the stories. We need you to tell the stories of our history. We need you, in a sense, to tell that story. And because of the fact that Reverend Dr. Matthews encouraged me to teach the class, then I've been able, in a sense, to help other people be able to bring out their creativity. Yes, it's not going to be right away. It's not going to be right away, but it's going to come. And see, the beauty of it is this, is that all of us have a story. And family is people out there waiting for that story to be told. And the thing is this, is that I'm just so happy that I can facilitate the research skills to people to be able to do this. But you have to understand, it does take some work. It does take some work. You're going to have to work on it. You're going to have to really be sincerely into this stuff.
Absolutely. You know, right now with what we're doing, we basically have created, and what you've done is created a no-fail system. If you take if you go through the process, you will succeed. Yeah. You know, I think it's like most of the group, a lot of the people, they're going through distractions. You know, we know now procrastination is a trauma response that's kind of built into Black people based upon what we know and call ambiguous trauma and loss. And it's the trauma that doesn't cease. You know, it's something that is constant and it's nagging, it's ongoing, it never has resolve or resolution. And it causes us to procrastinate. It causes us to shrink our lives. It causes us to start but never finish. It causes us in many cases to not get past go. So we just never get to it or get around to it. And so when we see people like Rhonda, you know, and Amram, all of the people who have published their papers, and now, you know, with Amra working with her with the AI, she's getting ready to publish her book. So I'm actually, one of the books that I'm writing right now is From Scholar to Author. So I'm going to walk the community through how to take their research paper, because the book, the paper that Rhonda just did, mm-hmm. and she sent me the email, she said she would like to expand it into a book. And I said, it has to be a book, because this is just a hidden history of Kemet that we just didn't know. And we need to know that. So I'm really, really excited about the teamwork that we're doing and where we're going, because now we can honestly say you can't fail the class, even though there was no grade system in the beginning. Yeah. But now, you know, with the advent of what I'm bringing to the community in terms of AI, along with the understanding of the fundamentals of how to do research, how to think like a research scientist, because it takes a moment. You're right. It takes a moment, yeah. maybe a year, before you start thinking. Because I did it. I didn't write a paper until a year.
Yeah.
Remember that? And I told you I was scared to death. I mean, I'm just going to be honest. But you break through those fears and you do it anyway, and then look at the outcome and how the community responds.
But see, also you got to understand is that sometimes, you know, when I was growing up, I was always attracted to French. I thought I was attracted to French because the fact, in the sense, is that I wanted to know the langue de l'amour, amore, the language of love, you know. But then when I was getting in my 40s, I used to have a dream every night, and the dream every night, and in the dream every night, I had this dream for years, and in the dream every night, I would be with some people. I was white, and I would be with some people, and I would have a carbine. You know, that's just a regular old rifle they use, you know, just a regular rifle.
Oh, okay.
And so then I had my carbine, and I would go up the steps, and I would never come down. And so then later I said to myself, oh, during World War II, I must have was in France. And that was just a memory. And so then, mm-hmm. and so then,
it was called an ancestral memory.
Yeah, an ancestral. Well, it's an incarnation memory because we have many incarnations, you know.
Absolutely.
So then, I look at people like Rhonda, Amra, and others. These are great people who maybe back in the day she was one of those people who ran the market, because you remember. We over here in the West, we always have men running businesses, but historically, mm-hmm. business has been the occupation of women, you know. Mm-hmm. And so mm-hmm. Sometimes I think about the fact is that Marie Antoinette, she plays the harp, you see, and when you think about this, man, just I am so excited because the fact is this is that, you know. Sooner or later, because I'm quite sure that with her abilities, the way she can play jazz, I mean rock and roll, she could probably play rap on it. I don't know, but the thing is, this is that given Marie Antoinette's skill, her ability, I just know that when she gets the time to relax, I had to believe that she was in Egypt. I had to believe that she was in Egypt once playing the harp. And when she gets the time, she's going to be able to draw on those genetic memories. And boy, the work that she's going to present to the world is going to be so inspiring, so great. But the thing is, this is that sometimes it takes that time. It takes that time. It takes that time to access the Akashic records. And there's stuff out there, you know, just like, you know, it's very difficult. It's very difficult, you know. Because see, we often imagine in a sense that the Akashic records, they're there, but we forget that sometimes you have to want to be in tune. You have to be ready to receive the knowledge. You know,
that's so true.
It's not just going to be there. But the point is this: is that if you take the time, if you relax, if you learn to meditate, you'll be able to find in a sense that hey. You know, you can go back and you can see those images. You can see those memories. You can see that. Damn, mm-hmm. is that what it's all about? Damn, mm-hmm. is that the mm-hmm. truth? Damn, is this the way? And see, that is the beauty. You see, the beauty is that the knowledge is there. You just have to draw on it. But see, but the whole point is this: is that it can be very treacherous. Because I remember I used to know a Hebrew Israelite brother. And he wanted to make a computer that could talk. That was back when you just had the little kits.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to make a computer to talk. And so then so one day he called me and he said, Clyde, he said, Naga told me how to make a computer that talked. I said, why are you telling me? I'm just telling you. I said, see, you and messed up because see, you're not supposed to tell everything that you've learned from a metaphysical perspective. You don't tell everything, see.
But you ever heard your mama say, don't let the left hand know what the right hand is doing?
That's right. And so then after that, you know, he had forgot how to do it, you know, because see, I don't like Nagashin anyway. I don't deal with Nagashin, but he was giving him that knowledge. But see, the whole point is that I understand that there's things on this world that are dangerous, just like there's things in other universes, other frequencies. You see, because see, there's everything works on frequencies, and there's always, in a sense, this whole idea of trying to be able to stay in tune with reality. But
absolutely.
But what is real? You know, what is real? Who knows? Who cares? But the point is this, is that it's very important in a sense that I love the fact that the people who've taken my course, that they're bringing out this knowledge and they're fulfilling my dream. They're fulfilling the dream I had when I first came on this platform. And the dream that I had when I first came on this platform was that family, you, I'm talking to you guys out there. The dream I had is that you and you and you would take the knowledge that's inside of you, the gifts that God have has given you, and share that knowledge with us, like what Rhonda did, what B-Man did, what you know, Baquette did, Sister Shanice, and on and on and on and on and on and on and on.
And Amra, and so on and so forth.
That's right.
Sister Shanice is in the audience. Shout out to Sister Shanice. Welcome back, Goddess. Gladys Harris is with us. Cheryl Lynn, who took our AI Jedi for Researchers class, couldn't attend, but she had to do the replay. Hopefully, I over-delivered, Goddess. You'll let me know. PJ is back with us. Pamela. Brave Cold Water, welcome, welcome, welcome. We've got Karen Van Zandt. Is also back with us, our beloved Tia Robinson. Thank you, Goddess. Power Inc., Brother Damien, who's also was in our, I think he was in our round, I don't know, was he round two or three? I remember Power Inc., but welcome back. Zachary Holmes from the big city, Chi-Town, Illinois. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Pay Muir, thank you so much for coming back. Darlene X. is also with us. Lisa. Melvin Reed. Melvin ain't gonna miss a show. I love Melvin. Melvin, we got the both Melvins. We got Melvin Reed and Melvin Wright back with us. Yes, the hell and Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. We got all the Mel's. you remember that group? That was my group.
Yeah.
Linda Tillman is with us as well. We welcome all of you, our beloved community. Thank you for your support. I see Dayon Epps is with us as well. Just came in. Miko Nashoba is with us. Finbar Jean Marie is tuning in. It's just amazing. So, brother, you told me something. excuse me, in the green room. Is it true that Halle Berry got tricked to do a movie?
Yes, it was announced today. I know I'd heard it, and the ad was you know, it was discussed by Professor Black, and that what it was is that you know, Halle Berry, you know, she played Storm, you know, in the X-Men.
Yeah.
And so then she said that this director of the man who was going to direct you know, the X-Men 3, he pulled out of it. Because he had found out that what the producer had done is that, you know, Halle Berry told him that, you know, she'd like to have a scene in the film, and in the and in the scene she would be in Africa, and it would be some starving black kids, and that she would be able, in a sense, to bring rain so that it could save the children, you know. And so then this director said that the producers, they wrote a fake script. You know
what?
Yeah, they wrote a fake script with that scene in it, you know. But then once she signed the contract, they refused to do it. And you know, and I was thinking about that, is that, you know, a lot of times those folks, they like to play with us, you know. I'm talking about the people mm-hmm. in the entertainment business. Mm-hmm. They like to play with mm-hmm. us, you know, like for example, you know, back in the day when you had gangster rap, you know. And you had all the brothers from the West Coast talking about, you know, how they hated the police. Next thing you know, damn, Ice-T, he been playing a policeman for 20 years. What the hell is this?
Right, you
know?
Right.
And then, right. And, you know, then they put Ice Cube in him, and see, then like Dr. Yeah. Dre, oh, he was such a militant. This last time I heard, he was just making some damn earphones. And a millionaire, though.
Billionaire.
And so these people they like to play with us. They like to see if you stand for something or you stand
right.
for nothing.
Right.
And sadly, it's very difficult. It's very difficult. You know, is that you hate to see people sell out, but at the same time, you know, people make compromises. You know, mm-hmm. you compromise sometimes to you know, if you have a family or something like that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember when I used to read about the British occupation. You know, to be an imam in West Africa as a result of what's called a Malinke Fiqh. That's the Malinke school of Islamic, jurisprudence. And so in that, under the Malinke Fiqh, you cannot be an imam. You cannot be a leader of the faith if you tell a lie.
Mm.
You cannot be a leader of the faith. And then, but there's so many imams in a sense that told a lie, and the lie they didn't want to tell on the revolutionaries. They didn't want to tell on the people who was fighting for their liberation. But at the same time, they because of their character, you see, they decided that they could no longer be an imam either. You know,
mm-hmm.
they could still be a religious scholar. And see, I mean, hell, you know, it's just like when I was younger. I used to always brag that I wasn't never going to tell a lie. And I never told a lie. And then my mother-in-law, she used to say, oh, you're going to lie one day, Clyde. You're going to lie one day. I said, I do not lie. I do not lie. I do not lie. She said, the minute that you married my daughter and y'all had children, she said, you're going to tell a lie. You know, said, no, I'm not. I'm Clyde Witters, son of Obie Witters. Shit. Man, when I got to college, I needed some food stamps. Hell, I lied to get them food stamps.
Oh, no.
Yes, oh, yes, no. Yes, yes.
No, you didn't, as the kids say. No, you didn't.
Yes, I did, because the whole point is that they set the system up. They set the system up that as a foundational Black American person, you have to lie sometime to survive. You have to lie sometime.
You have to lie all the damn time to survive in this second frequency environment. Just the English language alone is based and built on a damn lie. It has so many damn different meanings linguistically and everything. Everything is a damn lie in second frequency world. Of course.
You know, and so then, yes, I feel good. I was talking to my son the other day, and I felt real good because I could say that out of 46 years of teaching, I never messed over a parent. I never betrayed my colleagues. I never, in a sense, was two-faced. And I said, I feel very wonderful about that. Is that, you know, because then I was talking to my son, you know, because he's a manager, you know. He, a lot of my other sons, they kind of, I know y'all out there listening, and I'm going to tell them, y'all jealous of him, but, you know, because he's younger than them, but he's been able to get those super-duper jobs that pay really, really, really nice money.
Mm-hmm.
And so then, like I told him, I said, when he first became a manager, how old was he? He was 16. He became a manager at 16, you know, working at a shoe store. And so then, I told him I taught leadership at Governor State University. That was one of my classes I taught. But I told my son, I said, remember this. You do not ever have to worry about firing anybody. If somebody get on your nerves, don't waste your time trying to develop a process to fire that person. I said that use the innocence. That a person who's stupid, they're gonna fire themselves.
Mm-hmm. So then, You're gonna find a way to fail. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And I said, you have to do this.
Brilliant.
And he said, back in the day, he said, why? I said, because I'm gonna tell you something. I said, Betsy, you have to be able to live a life where when you have troubles, when you have things in a sense, when you have things that come negative in your life, you have to be able to say, wow, something happened negative. Oh, okay, well, that's my time. But I said, when you screw over people, when you're negative, then therefore, in a sense, down the road, you have to, you're going to feel something like that. You're going to feel, maybe in a sense, that you're getting the karma coming back on you. And so then he said, yeah, because he's had some hard times, you know, been out of work every now and then, you know. But the point is this, is that, as I told him, I said, the good thing is that you don't have to always be thinking about what you did to somebody and now you had to pay for it. And see, that is the whole point. And that's the thing about Halle Berry, you know, the gangster rappers and other people, you know, these people, they play with your life. They play with your life because they know in a sense that the whole world operates off money. Just like when I had to tell a lot to get those food stamps, you know. But I mean, hey, I was in college. I had a job. I had a little job, but I had a wife and what? I had a wife and what? Let me see. By the time I graduated, I had a wife and two kids. I had a wife and two kids. Mm-hmm. And the third one on the way when I graduated. So, I mean, hey, you know. So when, you know, you're on campus, you know, it was kind of bad because I really, you know, it's really bad when you set standards for yourself. And then when you fail to keep those standards, you know, it's kind of hard. You know, like my wife used to say, yeah, Clyde, you used to have discipline. I said, yeah, baby doll, I did. But look at me now. Look how fat I am. Well, hey, you know, I like that fattening stuff. But,
well, you know, I believe that what you're saying is partly true because, but here's what happens is that nothing, there's a concept in ancient African and sacred African science that nothing is missing. And because as you know, the law of thermodynamics, you know, energy can't be destroyed.
Right.
But what ends up happening is that, okay, you become successful of being able to take care of your family, you become a successful researcher. So something else has to slack because you can't maintain all of it at the same time. So you gain a couple of pounds. Okay, that's great. You know, some people, they stop smoking and they end up starting to drink, or they get fat and start eating. It's a transference and it's a balance. What I have learned over my years is I'm not trying to be perfect because I'm already made perfect because I'm a matus. So we're already made perfect, whole, and complete. Part of living in this as below existence is tapping into our divine perfection, which is why we have to show ourselves mercy and grace, beloved, because we're not going to get it all right. We have, well, this is a learning process. This is an evolutionary process.
It is.
And what you have done in your contribution, sir, to the planet, to the world, to the millions of people who have read your work that you will never meet, you'll never know, your contribution to India and all of the thousands, hundreds of thousands and millions of people from your work, if gaining some weight or gambling too much at the casino is your only fault, I'll take it. Yeah. I'll take it.
You know, but I know my wife, she told me once, she said, Clyde, I love the hell out of you. But she said, do you know what? I said, what? She said, I'm glad you had hard times because she said, if you would have really got everything, if everything would have fell into place for you, she said, we wouldn't have made it. We wouldn't have made it because you would have been an asshole, you know. She said, you would have been very arrogant, you know, and you didn't believe in failure. I said, who are you talking about? That's not me. She said, that's not you today. But she said, when you was younger, you couldn't understand how anybody ever failed because you felt that everybody should be able to accomplish whatever goal they set out to do because you felt you did it, you know.
Doesn't work that way.
Yeah. And, you know, and that's true. And so then she was right. My baby doll was always right.
She gave you some great wisdom, brother. You know, that's the same that happened to me. And I tell, you know, kids particularly, don't, you know, they if you go into the 2F work of, you know, setting goals, it's like you got to set a goal and you got to set an agenda. It's like, AMA doesn't work that way. None of us got here by following a particular goal or a path. We got here because there were so many kinks and bumps in the road, so many circles, so many turnarounds. There is no straight line to success. If I had followed the second frequency process, I wouldn't be Reverend Dr. Philippe Jacques Matthews. I wouldn't be a research scientist. I wouldn't be who I am right now. I'd be probably a guy with a J-O-B, a just over broke, living a life of struggle, trying to and dying with my dreams or potential in me. This is not what we are designed to do. And AMA has given us the code that is instilled in us to live our highest and to pursue our highest potential. Will we get there? Depends upon how many obstacles mentally we set before us. You would never have predicted that at age 70, whatever you are, that you'd be doing what you're doing now. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. You didn't even think when we were talking in the green room because of how militant you were. I didn't know you were that damn militant, but now I really know you were militant. You didn't know if you were going to live past 25, bro.
Yeah. And me and my wife, we didn't care about living past 25. We wanted to blow this mother up, you know. I mean, hell, you know, my father, he had shotguns around the house and you know, and stuff like that. And he had a 22 rifle. I mean, damn, we was ready. All we wanted him to do was go ahead. See, we expected back in the 60s, we expected because when you went down every alley on the telephone poles, they would have coordinates. I was in ROTC, so I could read. They would have little signs on it. I could see they were coordinates. See. Because they was going to artillery our ass to death. But me and my baby, we decided that, we were not going to die on our knees. We decided we were not going to die on our knees. You know, we were not going to die on our knees. You know, maybe now somebody could come and get my old ass. And all you got to do is touch me and I'll be on my knees.
Not without a punch, not without a fight.
We
don't die. We multiply, bro.
I got 21.
We don't die. We multiply. It's just a transition. You look at you slowing down. You ain't got no damn sense. You know, I'm slow motion.
I'm down and I can't get up.
Get this dang PowerPoint together now. Why are you talking about this? Is so powerful. We've talked about the Olmecs before, but this time you're talking about their calendar and the origin of this. Now, where did this come from, beloved? This is, I don't know how you keep topping yourself each and every time.
Because see, the thing is, this is that I love the Olmecs. I'm quite sure that that in one of my incarnations I was an Olmec.
You had to be.
I believe I was an Olmec, and so then I got some other shows I want to do with the Olmecs, but each one is different. But the thing is this, that I'm talking about the Olmec calendar because the European second frequency, they talk like we don't understand about the Olmecs, and they make up all these lies about the Olmecs, and they say the Olmecs are like this, the Olmecs are like that. We don't know their names of the people of the big heads, but I know the names of the big heads. I'm going to go through those. But see, the reason I want to talk about the calendar is that in this particular lecture, I want to talk about the fact that some of the character that this particular that the calendar of the Olmecs, you know, it's it talks about a King Yope, and I want to use this Stella as an example. I'm gonna do another presentation when I talk about the Olmec influence on the Maya calendar. And that I'm going to talk about the mathematics. I'm not talking about the mathematics in this, you know, because see, I want to explain to people, you know, why do in Mesoamerica today they have a 20-day calendar and all that type of stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, 20 days and all that. So I'm going to explain that in another lecture, you know.
Excellent.
I mean, hey.
Excellent.
I got a lot of stories until I run out one day. I don't run out too soon.
Ain't gonna run out too soon. Now you also have a powerful PowerPoint that comes along with this as well.
Yeah, you know,
and I know you were working on this thing till the very last minute. I was worried. I was like, "Where's Baba? He's usually in the green room by now."
Well, you know, like I said, is that a lot of times I wake up at 3 a.m. in the morning, and you know, the cosmic records or something, they just give me an idea, you know. And I didn't get to bed till
3 o'clock in the morning, just working. Well, that's because
you caught the research bug. You got to stop.
Oh, my gosh. The stuff that I have uncovered, I can't. I'm overwhelmed because I'm like, I got to disseminate it properly. I just want to do a big flush and a dump, but it'll come. It'll come.
Well, see, the thing about it's all your fault,
by the way, too. By all my success is your damn fault.
I'll take the blame for this. I won't take the blame if your lady start getting mad at you. Well, you caused that.
Too late. No, I wait for her to go to sleep. When I hear that first snore, I get up and I start working.
But see, the thing that I like about, you know, the chat GPT is that I can see how, you know, like I always tell the students in the class to make notes, and I can see how they could take those notes, and if they can learn the proper prompting from you, I can see how they can change their notes by saying, write this like a chapter. Then write this set of notes.
You know, what I love about it, brother, I was, okay, so here's the real deal, community. All right, so, yeah, I'm an AI Jedi, Black AI Jedi. And we're doing a series of books on this for the community because, you know, I'm gonna do one for research scholars and one for finance and one just everything covered. And I had been thinking about doing a special class for all the people who have taken Dr. Winter's research class. And because this class was inspired by him. And so I invited Dr. Winters to be a student, if you will, of mine in my class. Now, let me paint this picture for you, community. This is a man who is to me a giant. And I know he's a sweet guy and he loves his community. But Clyde is scary sometimes. This dude has done so much. He is so such a erudite. He is so collegiate. He has done so much as an academician that how do you teach someone that has been teaching for decades, damn near half a century? And so I was sitting up. Whatever little hair that grows back on my head, all of that fell to my face. I was a wreck. He doesn't notice. I'm telling him this for the first time. Because, and then Dr. Jimmy J. Davies, who y'all know, who was on my platform, who is the tech giant, right? And this guy, Every Dot Black, He has, you know, Every Dot Black in Africa and the Caribbean and America, and he was also a student. So now I have to train my teachers. I have to teach my teachers. So Clyde doesn't give compliments unless it's meritus and due. Clyde doesn't get excited about a damn thing because he's done every damn thing. And I'm kind of that way too. I'm jaded. I've been, you know, been in this so long. I know it all and do it all. So, you know, you really have to blow my mind. So we're going through the class. And as I'm going through the class, well, I'll let you pick up where I'm leaving off without giving away all the techniques that we did. But I basically did something in a class I've never done before. And that was, I made it very interactive, where I had you on ChatGPT, because this was a basic class. I didn't teach you Bard. I taught you a little bit about Bard, but there's like five or six different AI platforms that I use and that I teach. So this was the beginning and the basics, and everybody was completely blown away. I'll let you take it from there.
It was a fantastic thing, and I saw how the students how the people in my class could use it, because see, there's been people in my class who procrastinate. You know who I'm talking about. You out there, you hear me? You know who I'm talking about. I'm not gonna name his name, but I know he's listening.
I saw
how he could take this, and he's got thousands of notes, and he's been working on this topic for years. And the beauty of it is I saw if he could learn ChatGPT, how he could take those notes and then convert them into parts of his chapter. Because see, if you use the right prompt, you could just go piecemeal with the stuff and then Absolutely. Just add it all together. But again, Absolutely. Like I said, is that it was an exciting class. He blew my mind, but the point is this, is that I learn stuff every day. I learn stuff every day.
You never stop. That's the other thing I love about you, man, is that you do not stop learning. You haven't reached a point where you say, okay, I know it all, I've done it all. And the fact that you said yes knocked my socks off. I was like, well, let's go.
But
I was scared to death.
I understand it. My research is dynamic. Since my research is dynamic, I know other people's research is dynamic, you see. Absolutely. I don't have any favorite students. I don't have any favorite students, you see. But I will say this. If Shanice is a doll, that's my oracle. And Shanice, when she wrote that beautiful book on King Arthur, damn, that is a very powerful book, because that book is a book that every foundational Black Briton should have that book in their home. And then Baquette, when she wrote her book on a mother's womb, man, I have trauma from growing up with how I felt my mother didn't love me and my grandmother didn't love me. You know? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I had these traumas. And then I saw that Baquette's book allowed me to work those traumas out. So I'm very proud of those two. I'm very proud of those two. You see, and now I'm not taking nothing away from my other students, because they're doing great work, like what Rhonda just did, what Amber just did. But to me, Sister Shanice's book, her book is going to be the foundation of the liberation of Black people in Britain. And Baquette, her book will allow us to get over some of the traumas that we experience, because
talk to us about now, because I know we're getting close in time here, but beloved, and I want to get this lesson on the Olmecs and the calendar. So talk to us about how this all relates, because this level of research, you know, I think now after, what has it been, 2.5-3 years? Oh, she's so mm-hmm. sweet. Sister Shanice says, you are bringing tears to my eyes, Dr. Winters. She's so sweet. We love you, Sister Shanice. What we realize that, I hope that the community realizes that, you know, we're not out here selling handkerchiefs and bandanas and just trying to gank people and get money from people. We're literally trying to change people's lives and move people from one part of their life to a distinct new part of their life.
You got to look at this. You know, Shanice don't have to do none of the ish she does. This woman has a radio program. She does her videos. She does a news broadcast for the people. This woman loves her people. She loves her damn people. She loves the hell out of her people. And she not only Absolutely. Loves her people, but she got a man to take care of and a daughter. She don't have, when do you have time for that? But she's taking the time to share her love. And that's Absolutely. What it is, Shanice. It's none but pure love, you see. And I love to see love. And that's sharing the love. See, because absolutely. when you can share your love and you can share your love abroad, you see, that is the beauty of it. And that's why if she asks me to do anything, I'll do it.
You absolutely. Know,
except trying to fight because I only got 20.
Right? Yeah, okay. Don't ask me to go whip somebody's ass, Sister Shanice.
No, I can't do that.
That ain't gonna happen. Yeah. Call me. You probably need to call Will Smith or Mike Tyson for that.
And my son. My son with his little short ass, he's the best fighter in the family. He in his 50s, so he can't even help me
out. Oh, okay. Yeah, he's winding down. Yeah, all right, Jock, let's get into this class now. This is going to be amazing.
Yeah, let's get into it. I might skip over some stuff because it's a lot, but I'm gonna try to, in a sense, get as much in as I can. Okay, the Mande origin of the Olmecs and their calendars. You know, I go to my Patreon to see the slides. I love the people on Patreon. They're always giving me good ideas, and that's where some of the ideas from my papers come from. I'm on Twitter, Dr. Clyde Winters 8. You can go to my YouTube videos. Go there. I usually do a live broadcast once a month. And, go to YouTube and you can see all my videos, almost 300. And these videos are almost on all aspects of Black history. You can order my books on Amazon.com. FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry, or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. We are Aboriginal Black Indigenous people native to the United States. FBA ancestry is African. FBA heritage dependent on tribal origins and presence in the varied states. Aboriginal FBA were the first slaves in the United States. FBA historical truths, identity matters. There were the terms used to make Black FBA invisible was colored, minorities, African-American. You know, let's just face it. You know, the richest man in the world, one of the richest men in the world is an African-American, And he came from South Africa. But over 200,000 Black people fought in the Civil War to free themselves. Yeah, see, people forget. 200,000 Black people fought in the Civil War. Not only that, but it was 200,000 more Black people who would build up in a sense and clean up around the bases and help them fight. And then just look at some of this. 17,869 Black people from Mississippi, 24,000 Black people from Louisiana, 20,000 Black people from Tennessee. That was a border state. 8,000 Black people from Maryland, 23,000 Black people from Kentucky. They fought to free themselves. You know, Dr. Short, he does a lot of work in terms of ancestry. And so I told him to send me all the sheets of names of the winners that fought in the Civil War. It was some winners fought in the Civil War, baby. And then on top of that, I was looking at this book and it was talking about some of the ancestral names, because see what happened is that, when they did the dolls rolls, what they did is that instead of identifying Black people, the Black Indians as Indians, they would just copy down their names, And then I noticed in a sense is that, my surname is listed among them, I was really interested in finding out that my uncle, he's a really tough man, and he's from Mississippi, and I mean, damn, he was a walker, and walkers was on just about every list of Indians. So just to tell you, about 25 Black people during the Civil War, they won the Medal of Honor. We fought to free ourselves during the Civil War. They didn't give us nothing. They gave us nothing, And then you got to remember also that FBA culture is American culture. The food we eat, the tomatoes, the greens, rice, chicken, those are things that they got from us, the three sisters. They try to tell you, in a sense, that they try to have these white Indians out in Oklahoma. They're the head of the Cherokee tribe, the Choctaw, Choctaw tribe. Damn hell, ain't none of them, damn well, that how could they be the five civilized tribes when the five civilized tribes, they introduced food and cooking here. I want to beg the question. Will somebody put in the chat the name of a Native American restaurant. Oops, it ain't none. Southern cooking, we made it. We made collard greens. We made, in a sense, the bread of life. And what is the bread of life? The bread of life is them hoe cakes. Look on the bottom right-hand side. Those are hoe cakes. What it is that back in the day, the European, he gave us a pound of salt pork a week, and he gave us some cornmeal. And what did the brothers, what did the sisters do? Sisters took that cornmeal, they put some salt in that cornmeal, they boiled some water, they patted some patties out and threw them down, they cleaned the hoe off. You had a hoe! I didn't say a whore now. They cleaned the hoe that you used to plow the field, kill the weeds. They took that hoe, they would put that hoe on the fire, they slapped some of that hot water cornbread on there, and ow! Damn! That was the bread of life. Everything in American culture came from us. The music, the food, everything, everything. We are the people in the sense that set the pulse of the world. Everybody want a copy of us. They hate us, but everybody want our music. They want our swag. They even want to use our language. Yes, that's who we are. FBA built America before and after Europeans came to the U.S. We built the roads. We built the railroads. We cleared the land. American technological superiority came from us. He made the shoe machine. We had, in a sense, C.R. Patterson and Sons. They made one of their earliest cars, yes. Yes. But they couldn't really make the business process because, my man, and he went and talked to Carver. Carver told him how to organize the plant. And he created a plant system, so he sold all the cars. But C.R. Patterson, he invented a car too, but they just couldn't produce enough, so they couldn't produce the money. Charles Drew, great man. He, in a sense, he taught us all about blood plasma and all that type of stuff. That's controversy. Some people said he died because he couldn't get in a hospital because it wasn't a hospital around that served black people. Other people said he would have died anyway. The fact remains, they wouldn't let him in the damn hospital, so the brother died, even though he taught people about blood transfusion. He taught people about plasma. It was this invention of Charles Drew that saved a lot of people's lives during World War II. And then, Otis Boykin. Otis Boykin, he's the inventor of the resistor. All electronic processes, in a sense, go through the resistor. It was his idea about the resistor that led to the chips today, that all electronic devices run off. Your phone runs off these chips. This goes back to Otis Boykin, a foundational Black American. And then what about Mark E. Dean? He's an American inventor and a computer engineer. He holds 3 of the 9 PC patents. He made, in a sense, the first IBM personal computer in 1981. I don't have to lie. I don't have to make up no ish. And don't forget, it was some sisters who was able, in a sense, to calculate, not using a computer, but just by using, in a sense, traditional math tools, the voyage to the moon by the astronauts. FBA, you some bad shut your mouth, Shaft. And then don't forget it, Samson. Henry Samson invented the cellular phone. Yeah, that's that fat sucker, but today it's smaller. But see, that's what the European does. The European takes the inventions that we make and he just make it smaller and prettier. But we started off. We made the technology of America. And FBA historical truths must be taught. FBA economic independence has always been obstructed by the dominant second frequency. Every time they see us making some money, they got to knock you down. They had to, in a sense, bomb Black Wall Street. But I mean, I understand. The brothers in Oklahoma, they had a machine gun. And I mean, the Europeans couldn't storm the city. So they had to bomb them. But the fact remains is that they fought to protect themselves. Then they had all those riots in 1919 in Chicago, all over the place, just to destroy our economic wealth. They ran a lot of Black people out of Charleston, just when they, because they ruled the city, the second frequency ran them out. A lot of them got killed. Yes, yes, yes. And then finally the Rosewood Massacre. Yes, yes. Every time, you know, people want to say, oh, black people lazy. Foundation of black people, they don't try to do nothing. They should pull themselves up by their bootstraps. We do. But every time that European, in a sense, see us pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps, he tries to knock us down. Aboriginal FBA adopted Mongoloid Indians in second frequency. We, you know, was given our heritage. Yes, yes, yes. These Mongoloid Indians, they were nomads. They lived in teepees. We lived in houses. We lived in with houses surrounded by stockades. We built stone pyramids. See, but what they did is that beginning with Benjamin Franklin, he said that we got to mate with the red man, because if we mate with the red man, it won't take too long for our children over time to be white like us. And so that's why they gave them. They sent the Mongoloid people all over the country, said, you be this tribe and you be that tribe and you be that tribe and you be this tribe. And see, that's how it is. And they can prove they are the tribe because they got a card. They didn't give us no card. See, but the point is that they gave away our identity. But B1 is acknowledging your black African ancestry and Mott, not heritage. What is B1? B1 is unity with Mott. Dr. Marie Charles has noted that. Kim Dejet, Kim Dejet, Mott. Kim Dejet, Kim Dejet, Mott. To be black, speak thou, Mott. You know, we know a lot about ancient America. And we know a lot about ancient America because of the three great scholars, Dr. David Imhotep, may rest, you know, Ivan Van Sertima, and of course myself. You know, we proved in a sense that the Olmecs were black and that we were here before the European got here. You know, if you want to find books on ancient America, get my book, Atlantis and Mexico, African Empires in Ancient America. We're not just Africans, and Ancient Scripts in South America, you know. My book, Ancient Scripts in South America, is a very important book. What makes this book important is that I show how the people in South America did have a writing system. They always try to say that the Peruvians and the rest of the people tied knots. No, they used the Proto-Sumerian script down in South America, even up to Inca times. So get this book if you want to find out more about those scripts. Then my other book is The Mande in Ancient America. Then my book, The Black Mound Builders of America. Get these books, get these books, get these books, written by the original Hope Olmec, Dr. Clyde Winters. We have been taught a history of lies, a history where we are the victims of white racism. These lies teach us that we are a people too weak to defend ourselves because of the natural superiority of the European race over the primitive African race, whose emotionalism makes it impossible for them to do anything about the guidance and direction of the European. Yes, that's, yes, yes, yes. That's what they teach, but we do, we can, and we will, and we are a dynamic people. Foundational Black Americans are unique people. And the reason that we are unique people is that, yes, some of us came over from the motherland, Africa, but the vast majority of us, we were already here. We were already here when the European got here. We'd already built a beautiful civilization. We'd already built beautiful towns, but, and that's a really big but, is that we lost this country. We lost Africa to the European. Why? Because we fought among each other. We sold each other slaves, and then the European was able to rule us. You see, the only thing is that today, even though the European ruled foundational Black Americans, it's something in us. I think it's our Aboriginal heritage. It's being a Choctaw, Cherokee. And we think about the tomahawk. And we want the tomahawk. And we've been taught by our parents to fight. Fight for truth. Fight for reality. We even know we're going to lose and we still fight. And I think that comes from being an Aboriginal. Man, the origin of the Olmecs. Here we can see, in a sense, some pictures. Here we see King Yepo. We see King Tutu. These, in a sense, are images or inscriptions about these various important kings, but we're going to talk about the Mandean calendar. You know, we know in a sense that the Olmecs were called She. They were descendants of the Mande. You know, the other day, I was looking at some Algonquin material, and in the Algonquin material, there's this. They kept talking about she lamb. Is she lamb? I said, damn, is she lamb? What is that means, man? Then I remembered, hey, it's the same. But see, so many Indians, so many in a sense, Black Indian groups were speaking the Mande language back in the day. These are some statues of the Olmecs. These are some interesting stelas and artifacts, because the Olmecs were a unique people. We know the Olmecs came to America, to the Americas, around 1200 BC. You know, you can't base a relationship on phenotype alone. The Mande origin and the Olmecs in the Americas is based on writing, language, culture, features, and archaeological evidence. The key item linking the Mande and Olmec is the discovery through archaeological excavation of Mande writing at Olmec sites and the mention of the Maya that they got writing from the Tutu-Xi. They left fragments of the Tutu-Xi language, which can be read as an aspect of Malinke Bambara, which was spoken by the Olmecs. Here we see a picture on the left-hand side of a traditional Olmec or indigenous person. Then we look on the right-hand side and we see the Olmec. You can see that there's no resemblance. That's because these were two different people. The Olmecs were Africans. The Mayas, they were Mongoloid people. The Olmec came from Saharan Africa. They spoke Mande languages. Evidence of this connection comes from the fact both groups used jade, Amazonite, to make their tools. Amazonite was used in Saharan Africa. Look over on the left-hand side, down at the bottom picture. These are some of the jade artifacts. In America, that jade, in a sense, is green. In Africa, the jade was blue, you see. You know, jade was found on many sites in the ancient Sahara by archaeologists from the University of Chicago. Both groups made large stone heads. Here's an African head dating back to the same period. The Mande came to Mexico in boats from the Sahara down the ancient Niger River that formerly emptied into the Sahara. Here you look on the left-hand side, you can see a bowl in a sense, and this bowl has a boat. And that boat on that bowl is the same as a boat that we find from an inscription from Zapa in Mexico, you know. So it's very important to understand that we do have this evidence, you see. To understand the importance of the jaguar among the Olmec, you have to look at the Mande civilization. In Mande tradition, the first human beings were the blacksmith and the female, Musa Karoni. Very important. The jaguar among the Olmec represent the Muso Karoni, leopard goddess of Male. Muso Karoni represented fertility, as represented by the multiple breasts of the leopard jaguar. Okay, on the left-hand side, you can see a leopard, and that's the if you remember, mostly all of the elites, the rulers, and many of the priests in Africa would always wear leopard skins. And we find, in a sense, that when they got to Mexico, they found, in a sense, that there were no leopards, but they found a jaguar. And as you can see in this picture of the jaguar and the leopard, they resemble each other, you know, very much in a sense. The spots are a little different, but you can see that similarity. We know, in a sense, that what made the jaguar and the leopard so important in Mande civilization and the ideas of Black people is that they were masters of the bush. They knew how to live in the wild. This is a depiction of the Shama vase. Reading the signs, you see the sign, there's signs. I don't know if you can see this arrow, but these signs right here, when you read this, you can we find out who this individual is. A lot of times they say yes, that they painted themselves Black, so that doesn't mean they're Black. But then look at his feet. You can see his feet are brown, whereas this Mongoloid Indian, his feet are red. So you can see the difference among these people. But this is called the Shama vase. And when you read the signs in front of the Black priest, we read Bala Mahao, Jaguar Lord. The next group of glyphs we read, Tuninitu, the destiny of the ruler's soul is made superior. Yes, yes, yes. Even though they teach you in a sense that you can't read the Mayan inscriptions, we can read Maya. You know, I found a bilingual Mayan Olmec text back in the 1980s, and that allows me to read both, in a sense, Mayan hieroglyphics, the vast majority of them, and also Olmec writing, you see. All the people have this wildness given us by Muso Karoni. This wild part is called Wanzo, or the feminine force of chaos. Among males, the feminine is excised from the males through circumcision. Circumcision made the Mande Olmec male completely masculine. Right, right. Here, if you look at this top picture, if you look at the picture on the right-hand side, you can see this this guy about to be, be circumcised. You can see his penis. You can see the skin coming. You can see the various priests wearing the paddles. Now, just think about this. If you look at this, these paddles, you're going to find that many of the Dogon made similar paddles. So when you look at Dogon civilization, you can see how this paddle thing was there. And you can look at those, the regalia, and you can look at those headrests. Those headrests are so intricate. And you also find this among the Dogon people. And the Dogon people, they claim descent from the people of Mali or the Mande people. And this is a relief of Chow Katzingo. Remember we talked about Chow Katzingo? We talked about that a couple of weeks ago when I talked about the woman in ancient America. Here we can see some of the Olmec statues. In the middle figure, we can see a Mali figure, and look at the hands on the knees. Then we can see right next to the Malian figurine, we can see some statues from the mounds. Yes, the mounds that are found along the Mississippi River. You can see how these figures have the same pose. The hands are on the knees. And then on the outside pictures, these are basically these kneeling statues with the hands on the knees. The rest of the statues are all Olmec. So again, we see that first sight consciousness. And that first sight consciousness goes back to what Dr. Marie Charles says, that is that unity among civilizations from ancient Africa all the way up to the modern period, the medieval period or whatever, is that we do have this consciousness. I think that you can relate this first sight consciousness maybe to the Akashic records, in the sense that the Akashic records, it tells us our civilization. And if you can happen in a sense to gain the meditation and the study, you may be able in a sense to access these records that may in a sense help us to stay unified in a single consciousness. The Olmec language and literature, this is my book, Olmec Language and Literature. In this book, I talk about the Olmec language. I tell you how to read it. And in a sense, it tells the story of the Olmec language. In it, you will learn that we know the name of the Olmec is she, because this name they claim for the people who gave them writing. Okay, she, the X in Mexico is pronounced like the syllables SH. She. That's why, in a sense, you have an X, but the X is pronounced in Mexico as an SH sound. The OLL, Olmec Language and Literature, is divided into two parts. In the first part of the book, readers will learn how the Olmec writing system was deciphered and the She language and how to read Olmec text. In part two, I decipher and translate the major She texts. These Olmec texts include the Tushla statuette, La Venta Celt, the Mojaro Stellar, Olmec Heads, and Tiomas, to name a few. OLL is easy to read and provides explicit insight into the culture and religious practices of the Olmecs. It also allows us to read Olmec Stellars and Calendrics. Okay, here we can see, in a sense, on the left-hand side, we see an inscription. If I haven't told you before, and I'm going to discuss this in a future show, possibly. You know, there were roads that led from the Niger River Valley all the way to the Garama civilization in Libya. And along these routes, the people would ride chariots. They would use chariots as a major form of transportation. And then if you look at this picture on the left-hand side, if you look up in the left-hand corner, you can see some of the writing of the Mande people who lived both in the Niger Valley and in ancient Libya. And if you look at these characters carefully, you can see how the same signs, look over here, are found on an inscription on a cell from Ed Leventa. This is how we know, in a sense, that the Mande, they not only in a sense brought to America as the Olmecs, the religious system, they also brought to Mexico their writing system. And Another thing is that we find that in many of the Mayan languages, you know, the we can see in a sense that the substratum languages, that under every language, under many languages, you can find in a sense that although there's a surface language that you learn, there's parts of that language that shows that the ancestral language spoken by that people was different from the language that they may be speaking today. For example, this is from the Quiche language. You know, as I told you before, they always group the Maya. They talk about the Mayan languages. There's no such thing as Mayan languages. Researchers just developed the term to call those ancient people Maya. The people in Mexico didn't call themselves Maya. You know, don't get it twisted. They called themselves Quiche, Chantal, whatever. But as you can see in this list, this is a list of only a few words. You can see Ki, many. It agrees with Malinke, Kika. You can see in a sense that lineage of family was Ja. That agrees with Ga. Then we see Ja was the name for water. Among the Malinke Bambara, you had Ji, Ja, Ji, Ja, Ji. Then fire in a sense with Kak, Kak. And then fire in Malinke Bambara with Gandhi, you see. Palo means lake and river, and Ba and Blah means lake and sea. So again, you can see how Quichian and the Malinke Bambara, the language spoken by the Olmecs, you show what's called many cognate words. You see? The Olmec writing is read from right to left. The syllabic script was employed in the Olmec writing found on the mask, celts, statuettes, and portable artifacts in general. The hieroglyphic script is usually employed on bas reliefs, stelas, mahara, tomb, and wall paintings. The only exception to this rule for the Olmec writing was the Tuxtla statuette. Olmec was an agglutinative language. Olmec had mixed syntactic constituents because of the use of affixes. The base word order from the Olmec was subject, object, and vowel in simple declarative sentences. Due to the use of several prefixes in Olmec, there are some VO or vowel, verb, vowel, object sentences in the corpus of the Olmec inscriptions. Okay, here you can see some of the Olmec writing systems, you see. And, you know, on the left-hand side, we find part of the calendar that I'm going to discuss today of Yope. And then we can see the Kazkahal block on the right-hand side. And these are some of the inscriptions. It's very important to understand that the Mande or the Olmecs, they early developed the concept of zero. And they called the zero Fu, which means nothing. Here we can see a relationship between some of the signs in the Niger Valley and how they relate to signs at the bottom that are found on many of the inscriptions of the Olmecs. The Olmec language, remember, the Mande family of languages. The Mande language spoken in West Africa. You see, again, we can see this is right here. We can see these Celts. And these Celts, if you look at the bottom, have various writings on them. I deciphered those back in the 1980s. You know, the Leventa Celt, one of the main Leventa Celts, you know, when you translate it, it says, without breath, void, consumed lies the holy pay, below the family habitation, lay low the celebrity, the Lord, in the hemisphere tomb, the great Carpe in the back of the big hemisphere tomb possesses its place. And so then, as you can see, we found hemisphere tombs are mentioned. So we see that the mounds were used as tombs. And it's very interesting in relation to the Kazkahal stellar monument. You know, the researchers found a tomb, and you know, they found in a sense a mound next to it. So, but I'm going to discuss that maybe down the road one day. Okay. You know, Viner, in a sense, he was able, in a sense, to show a relationship between the Mande language and, in a sense, the Olmec by comparing the signs in what's called the Tuxtla. You can see that statue. That's a statue of the Tuxtla statuette. And signs, he was able to compare those signs to signs that were in the Niger Valley back in the, you know, early 20th century, you know. The most important find of Viena was the identification of Mandean inscriptions on the Tuxtla statuette. Although Wiener was unaware of the great age of the Tuxtla statuette, his correct identification of the African origin of the signs on the statuette helped us to decipher the Olmec script and lead to the determination that the Olmec spoke a Mandean language. The linguistic evidence suggests that around 1200 BC, when the Olmec arrived in the Gulf region of Mexico, a non-Maya-speaking group wedged in between the Huatecs and the Maya. And that was, in a sense, the Olmec people we call She, Olmec Calendrics. Calendrics is the reckoning and recording of time over long periods, the creation and maintenance of a calendar. The mathematical system used by the Mesoamericans was invented by the Olmecs. This system comprised of dots and bars to denote different numerical figures. Most researchers believe the Olmec calendar was invented during the middle formative period at the Olmec Center of Leventa around 800 and 400 BC. But the earliest Olmec dated monument goes back to 31 BC. In fact, in a sense, most researchers believe that the calendar used by the Olmec, which later became the calendar of people throughout Mesoamerica, was probably invented around 3100 BC. And if we use that as the date of its creation, that means that calendar goes back to the founding of ancient Egypt. And we had to remember that some of the nomes or the sapats, those are the city states of ancient Egypt, was made up of, in a sense, Mande people. Here's the earliest dated monument. And this is supposed to have a long count on it. The low relief on this stone has four-digit numerical recordings. Okay, the bars, in a sense, represent the number five. And then the dots, they represent the numbers one. So when you look at this, you can look at the numbers on this. We find 15, 6, 16, and 18. You can see the 6 in the middle. You see the 6 beginning from the top. If you can see this earlier, we got 6, 16. This up here is 16, too. This is 15, three bars. Then you got 6. You got 16, see the three bars and the one dot. And then you got 18. Here we got three dots is 1, 2, 3. And then we got three bars or 18. The vaginismal system on base 20 county system has been used across Mesoamerica. A value of 5 is represented by a bar and a value of 1 is represented by a dot, such that the three bars and single dot here stands for 16. The date of this relief is the oldest recorded date in Mesoamerica, corresponding to a day in the year 31 BC. Leo Weiner. The Olmecs introduced the calendar to the Mesoamericans. Leo Weiner, an African discoverer of America, was the first to recognize this fact. Leo Weiner was talking about the sacred calendar of the Maya called the Tzolk'in. Weiner wrote, in the first place, the central square contains the Mandingo tutelary god with his attributes and appurtenances. The numerical calculations based on 20 and 13, which is the essence of the American calendars, is surely built on African models. Here again, we possess but the scantiest material for verification, but just enough to be startling and unique. And this is very important, is that this is just to show you the genius of Leo Weiner. And the genius of Leo Weiner was that he just took this little evidence and he was able, in a sense, to show a relationship between the calendar used by the Mesoamericans. I'm going to discuss that calendar in another presentation, maybe probably in 2024. We'll see, God willing. But he was able to show his relationship. And what he did is that although Vienna was unaware of the great age of the Tuxtla statuette, his correct identification of the African origin of the signs on the statuette helped us to decipher the Olmec script and lead to the determination that the Olmec spoke a Mande language. The linguistic evidence suggests that around 1200 BC, when the Olmec arrived in the Gulf, you see, the region was already occupied by another group of people. On this Tusla statuette, if you look at the signs right up under the beak, because the name of this governor was Tutu. The Mesoamerican long cow day for this monument is March. Looking at these signs under the beak is 862417, which comes out to the date March 162 of the Christian era. He said in a sense is that what Viner used to really look at this, he looked at this he looked at the calendar. And many of the calendars used by West Africans, they were put on calabashes. Leo Viner in African Discovery of America also discussed the fact that West African zodiacs are 13 months, like the Amerindians. This information was based on the work of Bork Turkice of West Africanisch Kalibaschen in the Mittelruhen der Vorderstadien Gisdorf. And here's the article that he had, that he had read, you know. Again, like I said, is that, Dio Viner was a really super linguist. The Maya adopted the Olmec calendar. Cohen Stone noted in reading the Maya glyphs, they wrote, the first part of a calendar round is the 260-day count, often called in the literature by Ersat Maya name, Tsoak'an. This is the eternally repeating cycle and consists of the numbers 1 through 13, permuting against a mini cycle of 20 named days. Since 13 and 20 have no common denominator, a particular day name will not recur with a particular coefficient until 260 days have passed. No one knows exactly when this extremely sacred calendar was invented, but it was certainly already ancient by the time the classic period began. There are still Highland Maya calendar priests who can calculate the day in the 260-day count, and it is apparent that this basic way of time reckoning has never slipped a day since its inception. So it shows you how, in a sense, the Olmecs have a really strong calendrical system. Not only do they have a strong calendrical system, this calendrical system could be used even up to today in terms of saying what date it is, what and things like that. The sacred Mesoamerican calendar has 13 months of 20 days. John Montgomery in How to Read Maya Hieroglyphs wrote, I quote, the Tsoak'an, or 260-day sacred almanac, was widely used in ancient times for divinatory purposes. Guatemalan Maya and other cultures in Mexico still use it as a means of daykeeping. The origins of the 260-day calendar are debatable, although a number of scholars have suggested it corresponds to the 9-month period of human gestation. That's kind of interesting. Remember one of my earlier lectures when I talked about the ancient woman in Mesoamerica, I talked about the fact in the sense that the first calendar was invented based upon, in a sense, the menses cycle of the female, because men wouldn't touch their woman when she was on her period. They wouldn't have sex with her. In fact, they used to want them to go into a different house. And so that led, in a sense, to the calendar. But now we can see, in a sense, that in relationship to the calendar round, they think that the calendar round also relates, in a sense, to women, because they believe that it goes back to the 9-month period of human gestation. Again, as you can see, women have played a very prominent role in the history of civilization. Women have played a prominent role in culture. And even though Second Frequency likes to keep the woman down, and he definitely likes to keep Black men and Black women separated, your woman is, in a sense, can give you that intuition. She can give you that knowledge, because women have a very close relationship with the master, the creator, God, Allah. The Mojada Stella gives us keen insight into Olmec calendrics. There is a frontal inscription written in hieroglyphic and a side inscription written in syllabic Olmec signs. If you look on the left-hand side, this is the Mojada Stella. Okay. I took the time to decipher the monument and found it to tell the story of an Olmec king named Yope. In the inscription, we are told that King Yope was born was born on 143, the Christian area. It should be noted that dots and bars can represent both numbers and lexical items. Okay, if you look on that right-hand side, look at the bottom, you can see how those inscriptions look flat. And that's why a lot of times you have to record. You have to, in a sense, sometimes they have to have an artist record the inscription so that you can write them down and then we can decipher them. Okay, so if you look at that bottom picture on the right-hand side, on the left side, we see this is the front. This is the front of the stela. But there's also a stela. You see that edges on the side? There's also inscriptions on the side. And those inscriptions on the side, they're on the right side of the stela. So there's two inscriptions on the Mohada stela. Here again is the Mohada stela. You can see some of the signs on the stela. Here you can see an enlargement on the left hand side, we see the stela. We see the front of the stela. And on the left hand side, we see the inscriptions that are on that edge of the monument. They were quite loquacious, weren't they? The Mohada stela number one is a Mesoamerican carved stela dating from 143 CE of the Christian era. It is a stela dedicated to King Yope. It was discovered in 1986, pulled from the Aquila River near La Mojada, Veracruz, Mexico, not far from the Tres Zapotes archaeological site. The 4.5 foot wide, 1.4 meter by 6.5 foot high, 4-ton limestone slab contained about 535 glyphs of what they call the Isthmian or Epi-Olmec script. Again, so as you can see, this is a big, big stela, you know, to weigh 4 tons. And then look up there at the map, you can see where Tres Zapotes is. And we know that in a sense, this stela was born near Tres Zapotes, which you can see on the map. Okay, I have numbered the columns on the stela. You know, I numbered the columns on the left-hand side from 1 to 12, and then I began to count the other ones on the right-hand side from 1 to the end of it. The Olmec dates are made up of usually of the bar and dot pattern without the I-sig. That means, in a sense, I-sig is supposed to be an introductory group of glyphs. Even without the I-sig, researchers have determined reliable dates for the Olmec artifacts. This suggests that using the Tzolk'in, you can determine a date without employing the I-sig. This is why I maintain that the loopy sign is a lexical item rather than the I-sig. Row 1. In row 1, we find Itakio, Takokise, Takio. Thou sacred rising as a vital spirit exists now. You know, thou pure protector, or you are pure Kise. Badayo, the great Dayo. Sepodayo, the victorious and pure Dayo. Potu, pure birth, was on 585-335, and that's May 21st, 143 AD. Segyo, Thou art the Segyo, East, thou snake. Segyo is a surname given to an infant whose people describe the intervention of a divinity. In other words, in a sense, even when Yope was born, you know, the people saw him as a future, future important person for the kingdom. Here's the row one. Thou sacred rising exists now. Thou art the pure protector, the great Dayo. The victorious and pure Dayo's pure birth was on May 21st, 143 AD. Thou art the Segyo, thou snake. So that's what we find in this first inscription over here. You can see if you can see my arrow, you can see in a sense the loopy sign, and you can see the other signs, and we can see those dates. In the second row, we have the pure house, the big hemisphere sepulcher, burial pyramid is a talisman. Pure King Yo is pure moral grandeur and a pure propriety. The monkey king, Yo, has much propriety. The devotee is pure to realize and hold upright a good situation. The king and governor is obedient to the law. Oh, Yope. That's in row two on the front of the stela, the left-hand side. Again, we have the stela. Magnificent piece of art. Okay, Niyam is a co-power, special energy of supernatural origin. Niyam is considered the source of power behind every task. Among the Mande or the Olmecs, the pinnacle of potency is the knowledge of sorcery. Sorcery is important among the Mande, says McNaughton, because for the vast majority of Mande, sorcery provides a means for analyzing situations and a tool for responding to them. And these people can be quite open about their use of it. P.R. McNaughton, the Mande blacksmith's knowledge, power, art in West Africa. This book gives us keen insight into Mande traditional beliefs. And it helps us, very important to understand. This book helps us to explain much of the Olmec social concepts and religion. I must clarify my reading in line one. On the left-hand side, right-hand side, you can see the loopy sign. Instead of translating his middle sign as Ipo Kise, I believe you should read Ipo Kilisi. In the Friday, in the decipherment of the loopy sign, I failed to include transliteration of the dot sign Li. The lexical item C is represented by the black dot inside the middle symbol. Since Li is the middle of the figure, I am reading the say sign as C instead of say. Thus we have Kilisi reading the signs as followed. Ipo Kilisi, we have thou pure secret speech. Kilisi means secret speech. Kilisi is a potent formula of human sounds, rich with supernatural energy. It is Kilisi that provides an object with Niyama. Niyama, that spiritual, that deep energy, you know. Thus we can let's read in a sense those inscriptions again, the first two. The pure house, the big hemisphere sepulcher, burial pyramid is a talisman. Pure King Yo is pure moral grandeur and a pure propriety. The monkey king, Yo, has much purity. The devotee is pure to realize and hold upright a good situation. The king and governor is obedient to the law. Oh, Yo Pei. The monkey figure probably has an important meaning in this inscription and may represent an emblem. Among the Mandi, the Sulao monkeys indicate the initiate's awareness of his own animality. This suggests that Sulatu in row two should read a king aware of his animality. Again, the sense is that because of the fact that the Olmec in a sense were in a sense of the Malinke Bambara group, by understanding and knowing aspects of the Mandi religion today, you know, we find keen insight. Yes, we find keen insight into the Olmec religion, into the Olmec calendrics, into the Olmec way of life. See? Everything, as I told you, whenever you're trying to study ancient history, you must always go back to the key concept that's been taught us by Dr. Marie Charles. And Dr. Marie Charles has taught us that there's a first sight consciousness. In other words, there's knowledge within you and that you can grasp from, in a sense, the Akashic records that can help you to grow. It appears that the first day relates to the birth of Yope, who is recognized as Sage Yo. The inscription makes it clear that Yope was recognized as a god and the leader of his people's religion. To understand the designation of Yope as Sage Yo is explained by Mandi traditional culture. As I said earlier, I made a mistake and transliterated Pegyo as Segyo. Reading the signs as Pegyo tells us that Yope was considered a powerful religious specialist in addition to being the king. I do not believe the loopy sign was an initial series character. It was just a description of the potent supernatural power of Yope that Yope possessed. As says Yo, Yope appears to have had great knowledge of sorcery or Nyama. Say, foot foundation represents the beginning of knowledge. The Say symbolizes beginning and advance of success and power. The Say represents man's progression in pursuit of knowledge. Since Say means foundation and Yo is spiritual knowledge, Say Yo would equal foundation of spiritual knowledge. Yes, yes, yes. I try to tell you, family, our ancestors, they've left us so much important knowledge. Much of this knowledge we can't grasp because the Europeans, in a sense, they don't know how to read it, or they won't tell you what it's all about, you see? See, they don't put everything in books. Some things they just keep to themselves. Some things they know, but it's only taught among university professors and their students, you see? But I don't want that to be the only way. I want you to know those secrets that I can tell you. I want you to know these secrets. I want you to know our history, family, because you are a unique people. Yes, yes, not just foundational Black Americans, but Black people everywhere. You are unique. You are great. The left column shows a snake. You can see up here, see that snake? The left column shows the snake and the possible lone cow date of 8/5/1697 or 156 AD. And that comes to June 23rd, 156 of the Christian era. This suggests that Yope was recognized as Saitiji, master of snakes, on this date. In relation to the serpent snake in the inscription, it does not relate to a date. The Sai or snake's body forms the Sai sign. The snake rests on the yo sign. Thusly, we see the association of the snake with the sign yo. Sign indicates that we have the Sejo, foundation of spiritual knowledge. As a result, I believe that Yope was a Saitiji, master of snakes. Among the Mande, the snake is used in divination. The snake diviner studies the reptile movements, which he mystically interprets to answer clients' questions. The Saitiji communicated with snakes for numerous purposes, e.g. to foresee the future events and obtain secret knowledge, because he shares a supernatural bond with the serpent. The Saitiji is recognized as one of the most powerful diviners of the Mande people, who has the ability to perform supernatural acts. And see that picture at the top left-hand side, this may have been how, you know, Yope looked. And we see that he was a Saitiji, a master of the snakes. And that gave him mystical power. You know, it's very interesting. I've studied a lot of ancient civilizations, and the snake always plays an important role. And in fact, even in our Bible, in the Quran, you know, they talk about Adam and Eve. And we know in a sense that it was a serpent that tempted Eve, you see. And then, eat the forbidden fruit. Some people claim it was an apple. I don't know. I think it was probably a strawberry. I like strawberries. Shut up, Dr. Winters. It's none of your business. Okay. And this is the inscription on the edge.
Is it time for your sippy cup?
It might be, man.
Time for your sippy cup and medication.
Oh yes, because I'm trying to find my footsie so I can fill in my jammies.
Try to go sleepy night night, Doc.
Anyway, this is the Mahara, this is the side inscription. The newly discovered column of this text was published in July 1996. They had shown the front of the Mahara stela for years, but this is the side inscription. The new side text column on the Mahara stella provides interesting information about the Olmec people. This column of epi-Olmec text was published by Jay Justinson and Terrence Kaufman in a new discovered column in hieroglyphic text on the Lamada stella, a test of the epi-Olmec decipherment. They published this article in 1997, you know. In this article, Justinson and Kaufman claim that the decipherment of this text proves their decipherment of epi-Olmec using Meshechokian. This claim is false. The text was written in the Olmec language, which is a variety of the Mande language. They claim that the text reads as follows. This was their decipherment of the text, which was wrong. They said, and I quote, "Behold, there he was for 12 years, and then a garment got folded. He uttered, 'The stone that thus set in order were the symbols, kingly ones. What I chopped has been planted and harvested well. Shapeshifters appeared divinely in his body.'" That's what he thinks all these signs that are on the left-hand side, that's what he thinks that series of signs are. Okay, this new inscription came from a badly weathered and eroded hieroglyphic column. They were found in November 1995 on the side of stele number one from La Mojada, a riverine site in southern thing. Again, this is about Yope again. Okay, now this is my decipherment. My decipherment reads, "Thou art a righteous king. Thou art pure. Offer libation to this unique Ba of the Segyo. The pure grand refugee is smooth. Pure cleansing this refuge for the deified king and his refuge. The pure principle of life is in possession of this abode. The Ba is vigorous. This prodigious tomb. Number 10, I don't know what that sign is. You know, I don't know what that means. King Yope, this is thine refuge. Yope's principle of life to realize no vice in this good abode, habitation on terrain near the water. The prodigious tomb, the soul of the king sleeps. The soul and spiritual tranquility is established. His spirit has been put to bed. Purity. The soul is the pure righteousness of the great ancestor, Yope. The pure libation. Hold upright this hemispheric tomb. It exists in a unique state of spiritual tranquility. Pure is thine refuge, Yope. Righteous king, thou head, the government is pure." Again, this is what the side inscription reads. "Taiki, the sacred rising of a star, Yope. He is the summit of righteousness. This man is great. He glows at this moment. Yope is a rising star. He is the summit of righteousness. This man, Yope, is great. He glows like a shining star at this moment. At this moment, the pure image of the race and mystic order is full of propriety. The pure image of the race and mystic order, full of propriety, is Yope. In summary, Justin and Kaufman's translation of the Mojada Stella text uses Meshechokian, and it fails to convey the richness of the Olmec prose and the deep love and respect that the Olmec gave their kings. Whereas these scholars translate the new transcription as follow, I repeat again, I quote, "Behold, there he was for 12 years, and then a garment got folded. He uttered the stones that he set in order were thus symbols, kingly ones. What I chopped has been planted and harvested well. The shapeshifter appeared divinely in his body." But as I read, the real translation is more divine, is more eloquent, is more in a sense subtle, but it gives you an understanding of the great respect that the people in this town in Mojada, how they felt about King Yope. The decipherment by Justinson and Kaufman does not prove that the Mojada Stele is written in Zoquian. The authors translating this inscription admit they still cannot read the entire document using pre-Proto-Zoquian to interpret the alleged epi-Olmec logograms. This translation contrasts sharply with my decipherment of the new Mojada text. Yeah, and as you can see from my decipherment, it's much more eloquent, it's much more divine, it's much more aimed at telling you how they felt about this great king. You see, the basic problem with these people is that they think that you can read in a sense these ancient inscriptions. You have to use a proto language. I've written proto language. A proto language is just a made up language. It's a language that you look at words and then you say, okay, the word should probably be this or be that. But those are made up words. That's why you can't read proto languages. No. The key to deciphering ancient languages is the research of anti-Geop. Anti-Diop, in a sense, he created this whole idea of linguistic continuity. What linguistic continuity is that African languages do not change over time as quickly as European languages change. And because they don't change over time, I can use Mande to read these Olmec inscriptions, even though these Olmec inscriptions are over 3,200 years old. Yes, yes. But I demonstrated that in an article years ago. Justin and Cartman believe that this long inscription is about folded garments and a dignitary chopping crops while a shapeshifter appears in his body. My decipherment, on the other hand, based on the authentic language of the Olmecs, indicate that the Mojada Stella was a funerary text acknowledging the potent mystical power of the Olmec king, Yope. Again, in a sense, here you can see on the left-hand side, that's the front of the statue. And then on that edge, we find the inscription that I have on the right-hand side. This inscription is on the edge. It's safe to say that Yope had immense supernatural power. Thus his nickname, Seijo. He was also a Saitigi, and thus could see into the future and obtain supernatural knowledge via his snake totem. As a result of this, I do not believe that Seijo, snake, is a day sign. These signs probably related to the immense supernatural power of Yope. These are some of the Olmec kings. I'm gonna do a whole presentation, and I'm gonna tell you the names of the kings of all these heads. Yes, yes, yes. I can tell you the names of each one of these kings. I can't tell you their dates because they didn't really date the sites, but I can tell you the names of all these kings, and I'm gonna discuss that in a future presentation. Here you can see some of the various artifacts that are under most of the pyramids of the Mayas, the Mongoloid Maya, you always find maybe an Olmec pyramid up under it. These Olmec pyramids will often have, in a sense, the figure with the serpentine mouth and the stuff like that. And this is in the middle scene. I've always found this very interesting. I haven't never visited this site. But sometimes I wonder if I could visit the site, if there's some inscriptions that tell us more. Because see, our ancestors left us records. All we had to do is just read them. Here's an relief carved that's a recently found artifact. The reliefs are carved on a large round slab of limestone, 4.6 feet in diameter and weigh more than 1,500 pounds a piece. Wow. In the center of the headdress is an Olmec cross, a glyph of a jaguar that was a marker of belief status. The faces take up almost all of the artifact, bordered by footprints on the side and arms crossed underneath. You know, footprints always mean, in a sense, migration, movement, stuff like that. But I like this artifact. I really, again, like I said, one day if I ever go to Mexico, I'll try to look at these figures and see what other inscriptions are on them and learn more about who these people were. Okay, books to learn more about the Olmec include the Olmecs were Neo-Atlanteans. Get my book, Atlantis in Mexico, and my book, Olmec Language and Literature. Okay, as you can see in that middle picture, I was lucky enough that Yoshimad did some... He did the covers for my hardcover editions of the Olmec language and Atlantis in Mexico. And if you buy the hardback copy, you can see these beautiful pictures by Yoshimad. Yoshimad, the genius. This man has so much great ability. This man could really help you make money. If you have a company and you want to take your small business to the next level, contact Yoshimad, go to his website, contact him, and he can help you develop a program that can help you to sell more and more of that merchandise that you're making. I mean, this man can do it, you see. So contact Yoshimad, and he can make, in a sense, a website for you. He can make a jingle for you. He can make a video to explain about your goods. Contact this man, Yoshimad, the genius. Okay, again, this is just the, the Olmecs, Linus in Mexico. Nope, we don't have time to look at that, so let's go. Okay, again, in conclusion, the evidence presented by Mesoamerican archaeologists like Poole, Dill, and Cole make it clear that the Olmec introduced a unique culture to Mesoamerica that was adopted by the Mesoamericans. As these statements make it clear that there was no continuity between pre-Olmec cultures and the Olmec culture. Yes, the cultures that existed before the Olmecs arrived in 1200 BC, they have nothing to do with the Olmec culture, you know? See? And now we can look at these nine proofs, and it's these nine proofs that show how the Olmec culture goes back to Africa. And here you can see, if you look at number one on the right, on the left-hand side, this is the jade that they used to make many of their artifacts when the Olmecs were in Africa. When they came to the Americas, they found green jade. So they used that green jade to make their artifacts over here. The Olmec have left us fine stelae, statues, and inscribed artifacts to indicate their African origin. We can prove the Olmecs were West Africans by one, the Olmec writing system. Two, the religion is Mande. Three, the use of jade to make tools in Africa and Mexico. Four, the West African skeletons that they found. Five, the Malinke Bambara substratum in Mayan, Otomi, and Mishi languages. Six, the bilingual Olmec Mayan text. Seven, the Mayan tradition of foreign people landing at Panata. And eight, Olmec calendar. Yes, the Olmecs were an African people. Okay, again, join my Patreon to see the slides. You can find me on Twitter at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. Again, go to my videos on YouTube. Subscribe, you see. If you go to my YouTube page and you subscribe, whenever I do a live broadcast, which I do once a month, you'll be notified of it. And if you want to keep up and find out more about our history, you know, check out those videos on that site. There are almost 300 videos that cover just about every aspect of Black history, the history of Black people throughout the world. You can order my books on Amazon.com. Again, history books that deal with Blacks in America. Of course, Atlantis in Mexico, African Empires in Ancient America, and the World History of the Black Race. Get these books if you want to know more. If you want to learn about the DNA of African and foundational Black Americans, get my book, The Phylogeography of Afro-Americans and Africans. These books will enlighten you and you'll learn more about who and what we are over here. Again, my books are at Amazon.com. Thank you. Are there any questions?
All right. That was absolutely phenomenal, my brother. So appreciate it.
I made it up. I didn't think I was going to get through before 5. I hope I didn't go too fast, guys. You might have to look at this twice, but I tried to get.
I know you
got to
pick up your grand. Do you have to pick up your grandson?
No.
Oh,
okay. You know, that's why he doesn't get in at the train station until later.
Oh, okay. Cool. Yeah. So this was another one for the books, Bubba.
Were there any questions in the chat?
I don't see any in the chat, because I think everybody was just kind of blown away by the confirmation yet again of who we are as amazing first frequency people. And you also show the power of linguistics, you know, that you are a linguistical master, Sheikh Anta Diop. Understanding what is the term he called linguistic continuity, the fact that Africans linguistics don't change slower over time than the second frequency, and the fact that proto linguistics is basically something that's just made up.
It is made up
in a sense, kind of like social epigenetics, and you know, yeah. or all the things that the Bayesian statistics, all of this stuff is we don't know this. And this is why it's so important to have someone like you come and bring it back home to us. Sister Shanice would say, wow, wow, wow.
Wow, wow, wow. But you know, Sister Shanice, in her article that she's published, she showed how, I thought it was quite unique. She showed how that the people in Jamaica, how their language is kind of almost like the ancient Irish language. And I found mm-hmm. that very interesting in terms mm-hmm. Shanice, my oracle, you know, Shanice, she did a little linguistic work. But again, like I said, is that also people, Amra has a very super video that she's done. You should maybe look around on the internet and try to find it. She tells you about her life and how she became the great musician that she is today. So, you know, you should, speaking, hopefully you can find
of Amra. Speaking of Amra, this is how we sign off to the show today. Hold on, family. Here we go. This is going to be amazing.
It's an event. Now, to close the event, we call on Ilegba again, the one that opens a way to close the way. And we send them with love and thank them for helping us through the day. All I want you to do is to join me with one word, Ashe. And of course, you know our people, we always do it to rhythm. So here we go. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. That's your turn. Ashe, Ashe. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe,
Ashe. Ashe,
Ashe. Ashe, Ashe. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Ashe, Ashe.
Let's give thanks and honor to Amra and to Amma and the ancestors for bringing us such wonderful wisdom, wonderful sound, wonderful linguistics, wonderful frequency, first frequency. We are the one, we are the only. We don't die, we multiply. We give honks and thanks to Dr. Clyde Winters for deciphering all of this linguistics and all the code to prove that we always have been number one, first frequency all day, every day. We give thanks. We give angst, we give strength, love, and support in the name, nature, and consciousness of the one and only Amma. We repeat these words of power. I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
Asheo.
Asheo.
And so it.